you all for being here. So I'm David Scadden. I'm at the Mass General Hospital in Hematology Oncology, and I run the Center for Regenerative Medicine. I'm also a co-founder and co-director of the Harvard Stem Cell Institute with Doug Melton. And I've been very involved in thinking about ways in which what we've been able to do in hematology with the use of stem cells might be able to be applied across a much broader swath of biology and therapy. I do have a number of disclosures to make because of my, frankly, my commitment to trying to make some of these discoveries things that can move forward to patients. So just a bit of a background on stem cells. Not all stem cells are created equal. They are really very much dependent on where they come from in our development. So there are cells that are so-called pluripotent cells that can make any of the cells that are within the embryo. And those really form very early on within the first 10 days following conception. And then once the gestation process begins, things get much more constrained in terms of what they can become, with what we think of as being stem cells in the adult body as really being so-called multipotent stem cells. So a blood stem cell is terrifically able to make all of the different cell types of the blood, but it will never make a neuron. It won't make a liver cell. One of the fascinating changes in the field that has transpired over the last 10 years is the ability to take cells that are from an adult and actually now reprogram them. And that process involves a culturing process, and then essentially using a simple genetic trick to get these cells to rewind in their history and to forget that they're blood cells or skin cells or any other cell type. And they can be rewound back to becoming a cell type that's capable of making any cell type in the body. It can become a so-called induced pluripotent stem cell. And that has been a tremendous revolution, both in the way we think about biology, it's no longer just a one-way street, but also in the way we think about cells as programmable units rather than something that has a fixed identity. And finally, it offers an opportunity to get away from some of the ethical challenges of yesteryear in terms of using early embryonic cells, and now being able to take cells from any one of us at any point in our lives and making these cells that you could imagine would be of tremendous potential therapeutic value. So how do we think about using these cells? There are a number of different ways in which we have considered the stem cell to be an application to medicine. The most simple one, conceptually, is to use it as a replacement part. And that's certainly been the way in which we use stem cells in the past. With blood stem cell transplant, that's also, frankly, the basis of being able to do things like skin grafts, where skin stem cells expand out to become skin grafts, or to use bone grafts, where bone stem cells actually then enable production of new bone to do often spinal fusions. That simple model is the one that still dominates the field in terms of the way in which we are moving things to the clinic. But there are other ways in which we can take advantage of this new biology, one of which is getting a great deal of attention now as an approach to aging, for example, is the idea that you can reprogram cells at will to become other cell types. And certainly there are lots of animal models where it's been shown, for example, that the part of the pancreas that is making enzymes for digestion, the exocrine pancreas, can be reprogrammed in the body to become more of an endocrine part of the pancreas and to make insulin. That has been difficult to move forward into any clinical application, but the idea that that will be a part of the way we can change cell behaviors and cell states in the future has, I think, now been demonstrated and is becoming an area of particular emphasis. And you may have heard of companies like Altos that are really trying to use this now as a strategy to reverse what is an inexorable decline in cell function to a more early stage state so that it can become something that will be more vigorous and useful. In addition, there are ways in which we can try to take advantage of the fact that many of our tissues have stem cells within them. Now, these are stem cells that we know have very different properties in vivo, for example. The blood stem cell is constantly replenishing the blood. It's making 100 to 300 new blood cells every day. So with your last heartbeat, you just made a million blood cells. This happens continuously. Whereas, yet when we try to culture blood stem cells, we can't do it for long. that's different in the brain, where we know the brain stem cell exists, it can propagate rather vigorously outside the body. But in the body, we know that in the context of stroke or other injuries, it does very little. So understanding ways in which those signals are governed in each of these tissues will, I think, ultimately lead us to therapies that can change the activity of the endogenous stem cells present in our tissues. And then there is a way in which using stem cells, particularly pluripotent stem cells, to create essentially organ models, where if you allow the cells to differentiate in vitro, they will make not just a single cell type, but multiple different cell types, and they can become organoids. Organoids that can resemble the intestine, for example, in its complexity, or as you'll hear about from Dr. Bonventre about the ability to use these cells to create organoids of kidney. And these can be fantastic models for both understanding of disease. So, for example, if you make an organoid from an individual with cystic fibrosis, you can evaluate how that person may then respond to particular compounds that are being developed for cystic fibrosis. They're also very useful as ways to try to create collections of cells that might ultimately represent transplantable organs, small mini organs. And that's an area of ongoing investigation that, again, you'll hear more about in a moment. So it's really this first category and the last category that is where we are at the moment in terms of clinical application. And those are in different ways, which I'll mention in a second. So these induced pluripotent stem cells are being used in the clinic. They are either being used in a non-therapeutic role or in a therapeutic role. And there are active trials in 19 different settings where iPS cells are in patients today. The non-therapeutic applications are often in making these disease models that I mentioned as a way in which you can test how an individual who has a particular phenotype of a disease has that phenotype. That is, you can modify the genes within these cells to determine what are the genes that are driving their particular phenotype. There's also ways in which these drugs in vitro can be used for drug screening. So, for example, colleagues at Stanford have made cardiac models that they then can test whether an individual's cardiac cells are more or less sensitive to the cardiotoxicity of drugs that are often used in cancer chemotherapy, for example. And then there are those trials that are ongoing in patients. And in patients where they're being used essentially as replacement parts, there are these 19 different trials that are ongoing. The majority of them are using allogeneic cells, meaning that they come from a different donor. And the number of cells that are autologous is actually much more modest. It's only 4. The reasons for that, even though the autologous, you can imagine, would be preferable in terms of the lack of immune reactivity, is, of course, that these are not simple to make. They're extremely complex to generate. That cost and complexity is one that is a real barrier to using autologous iPS cells therapeutically, though I think those kinds of technical barriers may very well become less problematic in the future. So we would hope that this would be a more balanced progression of allogeneic and autologous cells moving forward. So the trials that are active are in a number of different areas. And some of these actually have very, very small numbers of patients that have been treated. But others are more active. So, for example, there's now several years' worth of data being generated in the area of neoplasm, where a company like Faith, and full disclosure, I'm the founder of Faith Therapeutics, has generated an immune cell that is capable of targeting cancer cells, an NK cell. And that NK cell is then being tested in cancers that are refractory to other therapies. Faith is not alone in this. In part, that has some recent data that they've also recently published, and many other companies are doing it. In addition, there are ongoing programs in diabetes that I'll mention more in a moment, but this is clearly something that has garnered a tremendous amount of interest and attention. It was on the front page of the New York Times here recently. And then there are efforts ongoing where patients are being treated now with Parkinson's disease, with IPS derived dopaminergic kidney syndrome. In addition, the blood forming cells, people are advocating that we can make enough blood cells to be able to no longer depend on a blood bank. I'm rather skeptical of that, but it is
something that is moving forward and is not in clinical trials if that's okay. So these are areas that are moving forward there. The places where this is being done, the number of clinical trials is greatest actually in Japan. But the number of patients enrolled is greatest in the U.S. So in Japan, because of their regulatory structure, they are often off types of therapies that are possible. And so a number of those have moved forward in the eye, in the heart, in other settings. Whereas in the U.S. and China, there have been more patients enrolled and a smaller range of different study types. So what are the trials that are really in many ways leading the way? One is, of course, in diabetes mellitus, and actually two companies doing this. But the idea here is, of course, to be able to take a pluripotent stem cell, and in the case of Vertex, this is from an allogeneic donor. It's not a relative of the person who's in need. And there is another trial using ES-derived cells. But the idea is to basically move these cells forward in the differentiation program so that they no longer have any of those characteristics of making all different cell types and are constrained to a cell type that makes insulin. That has been now implanted, and the results are still very early, but look at the impressive way in which that has reduced the insulin requirement of the individual. They have no longer had hypoglycemic episodes, which were otherwise threatening for at least one individual we've heard about. And one of the questions, of course, is whether or not these cells from another individual will be able to be tolerated long term. And so this is a major challenge in the field, is how do we overcome immune barriers if we're using cells from another individual, and in particular in someone who might have an autoimmune disorder. That idea of being able to use cells to essentially have a replacement part has moved forward now, particularly in tissues where there isn't a great deal of integration required. That is, there is no complex network of cells within the beta cell and the pancreas needs to physically interact with its job. It just needs to be able to sense the levels of glucose in the plasma, and it needs to be able to produce an appropriate amount of insulin. That's also, of course, true in the blood. So these are two areas where there's been the most advance in using iPS-derived cells. Now, one of the interesting elements of the cells that come from iPS cells is that iPS cells can be grown essentially indefinitely and are very easy to genetically manipulate. And so we can imagine that these cell therapies going forward are not just going to be to try to enable the mature cell to be produced, case of diabetes, but to actually outfit the cells with super physiologic properties. And that's what's being done in many of the immune therapies that are being developed. This is just one of the slides from the UK Therapeutics website, which shows that they have now given these cells new genetic capabilities that allow us to think about cells not so much as replacing what was already there, but actually providing superpowers for the cell so that they can do even better at the job that they were originally outfitted to do. So that's an area that I think we'll also see emerging over time. And then finally, just the complexity of the things we need to think about as these therapies are developed. Protection from immune attack is a major, major barrier. There are ways in which you can potentially make the cells immunologically different. But that is, of course, really challenging because if something goes wrong, if one of those cells becomes a bad actor, no longer have to fix against it in the immune system, and that would be potentially devastating. The other is this issue of integration of existing tissue. So while we think it's terrific to be able to have dopamine producing neuromites transplanted into the brain, there are clearly examples where people have done that with fetal tissue, and it's resulted in a worsening of the outcome. So there are integration issues that we need to be solved. The issue of genetic and epigenetics. Integrity is very complicated and a really tough area to have a good sense of the safety of in the product. And then finally, the consistency of that product, all of which are challenges that we're going to be solving moving forward. And I think I've taken up too much time. Thank you for your attention. Joel, I'll turn it over to you.
a really interesting David mentioned the term organoid, and I'll add to it the term steroid. These are 3D stem cell or other cellular derived structures. And so on the left, there's the kidney organoids, the two panels there are showing that you can get these structures which have developed from stem cells. And you can get structures that are not completely organized in the way that you'd like them to be, that they are in the organ. But nevertheless, you get structures that you can study in a variety of different ways, and that serve as the first building block you can to ultimately put the organ together. In the middle, there's liver organoids, and the right brain organoids, and you can see that you can get the brain organoids. Then there's steroids, and on the bottom left-hand side, these are cells, podocytes, important cells in kidney structures, and that have been generated from the organoids, from the organoids first, generating the cells, and then letting those grow together. So you have a mass, a cellular mass of podocytes. Now, you can do that in a variety of different ways. In the context of naked steroids, you can do it, for example, cancer, and cancer steroids, and cancer cells. And what we've done, for example, is make cancer steroids and incubate them with put them together with the kidney organoids, and we can measure the patient, which is a model that can be sort of developed. On the bottom of this slide, there's engineering interactions whereby the steroids or organoids can be generated in engineered structures, which is both the notion that they can be ultimately become functional or develop a system to make them functional, or at the very least, serve as a viable tissue alternative to human tissue for drug evaluation. And so the impact of organoids, which is David's already mentioned this a little bit, in making iPS cells from patients who want to use gene editing approaches to modify them in a variety of different ways. And then one could use them in disease modeling, drug screening, efficacy testing of new drugs, toxicity evaluation. And in clinical trials of the gifts, so you can potentially imagine that if you make organoids from patients with different kinds of diseases, you can then personalize the therapy. Because again, you're dealing with human tissue that's not perfect in terms of its differentiation, what it looks like in the individual, but it's much closer than many other models. David also mentioned the notion of the potent sense. And here's where the terminology gets a little bit confusing. What some people think that stem cell has to be turned on, it has to be all types of things. Other people use the term in the context of multi-pregnancy. So it doesn't make all the types of stem cells in the body. It's not like an ideal state. But it can make a number of different types. So one thing is that a particular cell type that tends to be called a progenitor cell. But here's an example of what we use. A multipotent mesenchymal stromal cell, or people call it, again, mesenchymal stem cells. And spheroids, and here's what I call, for example, making spheroids of these cells, and then putting them into the bone in fact, with the dose that can be generated. The bone not only because it's the MSCs will differentiate the bone, it's not just that simple, they can do that, but they also produce a number of other molecules that may modify the inflammatory response. And so in many cases, these cells are used in a variety of different contexts. In many situations, they're creating a character effect, that is, it's not that they're changing into a particular cell type, but they're impacting the inflammatory response and then secondarily impacting the disease process. Okay, and then another way you can use the cells that you obtain from IPS cells. And you can put them on engineered structures. And this is sort of a few examples. In the left two panels, or two panels, for example, Lewis's lab, or harder, basically cells can be put on these printed devices. In this case, then you can try to reproduce the structure as it is in the body. In the middle, it's a dark kidney nephron. That's actually a real kidney unit that describes what it looks like in the context of how complicated it is. And on the right, it's a way of trying to make that in three dimensions using the printing technology. And then you go through the kidney on cells that can allow the stem cells and make the proximal kidney. There are issues relating to that. At the bottom right, the issue is where you make a lot of these structures, how do you pack them together and get the equivalent of, say, the 50 of a dozen units? And what does that have to look like? It doesn't have to look like a kidney, but it has to function like a kidney. And then, of course, there's sort of the holy grail in some ways. So we talked about on the left two panels, this is the making kidney organoids. More recently, so, and this field is relatively young, published in 2015. It hasn't been around that long, but right now we're about to publish this one. On the right hand side, which is another kidney organoid made from another part of kidney embryology. So the kidney comes together with two forces embryologically. So there's reason to think that you shouldn't be able to make a whole kidney if you don't have all the pieces. Now we sort of have both pieces. And so now what will happen is try to put it together and get it to talk to one another and hopefully get connections made. It kind of just seems like Star Wars or whatever. But again, we didn't really have two categories to really do this. So the field is moving very rapidly. And then I put it in a more macro scale in terms of the use of some of these technologies. So in the context of thinking about regenerative medicine, as we do with other organs, like failure, with cirrhosis, pancreatic failure, we think think about it in support, it's like a support structure for all of the completely different structure. And this was a project that developed a roadmap to innovative alternatives to dialysis. And this project was started to lower up things about incremental treatments to dialysis. So most of you know about dialysis, but dialysis is the 5-year survival of patients on dialysis is approximately 40% the survival of dialysis. And that's much worse than most cancer. And so, this is a and patients really help with the treatment. So we need to do something. We have a funding that says really accepted by dialysis for my pain. And so this is an attempt to try to think about how we would go from what the roadmap basically in terms of getting to where we want to be. And along the way is the wearable devices that could be mechanical, that are not cellular, hybrid devices that could be cellular and mechanical. Chimeric or human transplantation, I have a slide of that because that's something that we use a lot. And then ultimately our goal is to regenerate or rebuild the biological kidney. But along the way, we can't wait to that point because we can't predict exactly when that's going to happen. So patients are suffering in that particular way. And along the way, just this diagram also reflects the realities of dealing with regulatory considerations and financial and coverage considerations. This is a major industry, as all of you know, and that's good, but it's also introduces a number of other values. So, this is my next to last slide. And when nephrologists or people would do something about the kidney, they were asked what would happen in the next 20 years. Basically, 37, what were the most important for people to be replaced and not today? 37 to 38% said that it would be either subject to implanted artificial kidneys, genotransplanted kidneys, so printing system, another biological system, either the deal with cell system, which is the way it was presented to the people in the survey. And then second was a wearable artificial kidney. So this is something that's not quite as good, but better than where we are now. And that was either hemodialysis or cardiac dialysis. And then third was the blood-based therapies. And in fact, only 14% said that either there was gene therapy or stem cell derived kidney fighting. And then the last slide is, this is the census regenerative, so this is the point of view of the patient. It's a little bit genome transplantation is something that we've talked about in many, many years. And more recently, there's been some progress. And I think particularly in the market, it's supposed to bring some kidney transplant that relates to a basic brain drain. Both kidneys are removed, and then there's a big kidney was attached. And that patient was retained alive for 74 hours. There was no type of acute reaction rejection, which is the big problem with the human body recognizing pig elements that make a temporary request reaction. The vascular integrity was maintained. This is a summary by the office, but in fact, this is better than a good intuitive source. It's clear evidence for vascular problems. It just wasn't as profound as perhaps others might expect. However, the kidneys did not achieve normal function. So we're not there yet, but it's an interesting event. So with that, I'll stop and two very comprehensive presentations that they provided a lot of background. Certainly open up to questions. But we start with where do you see this challenges and headwinds to advancing this technology and more towards the bottom?
I'll comment that. I think they're in the clinic. So many of these barriers are already modulated down. So we know how to overcome the issues. Hurdles that need to be overcome to be able to increase the patients. We know a lot about what's going to be measured over time. I think one of the things we don't know is durability and whether or not there is some low frequency mischief that's going to come out of the cells that we will not know until the first people bring them to go through. Those are things that I think are worried about most of them. I think there are other issues, particularly in the cell processing and making sure that we have a uniform material. Most challenging to sell products, those areas are ones that I have confidence in trying to compel it. And the new problem is just one of them.
Yeah, I would think, you know, in some ways,
I think when you can deal with one study like even the river, where you can make a deal with one on the catalyst of delivery strategy, the catalyst of the system, the failure of the system. So, you know, you can probably get a system to have a handle of the catalyst. Maybe that's okay, but you have to deal with the products of the catalyst. Maybe you can do that pretty structurally because of the different types of the catalyst. But that's another thing that one has to think about. You don't have to look at the table and control the energy that has to do with all the things that you can't control the system for all of
them. You bring up a really good point, and that I think is a great segue to another question that I'd like to bring up now. What do you think stem cells and the technology discussed here is not looking for? And I think I heard those skepticism about the idea of maybe doing away with blood disease, but for both of you, what do you think about this technology longer term? How do you think this is not ideal?
Well, I think in these early days, it has to be focused on people who have developed blood disease. Until it doesn't work out, it's going to come from the drugs that we have taken. I voiced my skepticism about that, but I will say there are things where we know that the production of the renal cell is of such magnitude and perhaps such complexity that envisioning moving to the clinic and having to be involved in product is because we do have a challenge on so many levels. I think the idea that we can use that kind of number of studies in a cost-effective way is going to be the middle of the problem. I think we're going to get around the biology of having to be functional, but it might just be hard to make out to be able to be effective.
The other related, using these technologies to care about what the therapeutic is going to be useful for the disease because it has been so we can use these technologies as a tool to protect our human tissue and to make it more structural than previous models. And then we can put them to the animal models. It's more focused, but it's not really helpful to the animal.
Let's switch gears again. Start with Joe. One of the things that struck me about your presentation was the fact that equal numbers of physician scientists thought that the answer to the intergeneration theory would be stem cell drive, which is kind of which again I thought was interesting given the kind of context of the scientists, but that is a kind of an interesting point. Do you think there's still a lot of skepticism in the field as to what the best approach is going to be, or is that
kind of grounded? I think there's skepticism about this so much for students to say that. I think you ask most people to say that it's not likely that they the other two, you could get a lot of the time. you can get by with a system of function. You don't need a rotational solution. And so, and especially since there are many drivers that can see some of the complications.
Well, I think we're still trying to work out the cues for that. So I think those will be the things that take a lot more academic time and investment. The things that are moving in the clinic are really ones where people have already invested at the time. So I think the thousand has stepped over 15 years to get out of the power of the sort of early steps that open up the next one that we get in the morning. That's about the magnitude of the first thing to take from the next one. So I think in those areas where it doesn't require an operation for the rest of the tissue, like an endocrine organ, that's, I think, a fantastic opportunity. That'll be coupled, I think, not so much with the way it is now, with the suppression, but perhaps by being able to use devices that encapsulate the cells so that they're no longer formed into the interactive process for the pathology of your system. That's like a reflective thing. The brain is the other area where this is a big idea. Both of those are included in this work. They have the clinical trials that we're finding out a lot more about. They are advantaged because of the science that people are going to be pretty much science.
Thank you.
As you're thinking about the question, I'd like to get in one last one. Indulge my wayward view of science fiction. But you mentioned in your slide, David, the idea of a superphysiological function. I'm curious, you know, in your mind's eye, where do you see the technology going? Is it possible to get a sign of blood space for maybe not just an athlete, but a firefighter? I think we're going to explore the whole thing of cancer. To read the outside cells with the capacity to kill cancer cells versus get them. But I think it'll be more than the cells that determine the cancer. But really, CAR T is representing the disease. We know that you can make cells that are already have an endogenous function that's quite powerful, but not direct them in the way of such as you can. It's a super physiologic function that has tremendous therapeutic potential. So that's really the first such. I think it's also going to be cells of the blood system that are first going to be outfitted with these capabilities. It's going to be case cells, but I think there'll also be companies that started to try to outfit them, so macrophages and capabilities. I think, you know, the idea that the cell is a programmable unit, we really can't outfit its function and say that that's what we're down to. I think that's going to be an exciting part of the project. You'll have some creepy aspects to that, but I do think in the meantime, we're going to be able to find opportunities to have things arise based on the endogenous intelligence, if you will, of the cells. Those cells know how to build the cell picture, whether it's injured from a world picture. Then you can provide them with molecules that cannot either secrete or come up from the surface that you can actually have for them to get ways to do something different than the normal secret process. Because we've done less of those hardwired to make scar rather than to regenerate. I think we could be able to switch that. Questions? Raise your hand. I said, Edward, the wrong therapy. Question. Thank you. Look, this is a new topic as well as you would. The information on the transplant even as it relates to morning, so I share your concern about this. I do think it's been something that's been tested, as you know, in a couple of different settings and experimental models. So I mentioned that people say things that have different characteristics, it's also been converting points out to the fact that that might be a little less complicated because of the properties of the deal. And everybody would like to have more cheesecake for this one. Okay, a lot of volunteers. But other places where it's been tested, I have a real concern about. Where you have a partial differentiation, the differentiation is a part of the potential to have abnormal conductivity. So I think there are ways in which you can select your particular way in which you might test that. But as a broad based approach, I market the other part of the house, which probably was the first. We're trying to get these people to the therapy. And I think that coupled with the unpredictability of the epigenetic program, like, if you have to do online marketing, it's over something.
Thank you.
Yeah, only because I think there are lots of ways in which proteins are going to be distinctive from one species to another, and it's going to be hard for this regulation to happen. And I also, given recent epidemic issues, I am concerned that the combination of the two species, knocked out enormous numbers of these endogenous viruses, but there are ways in which primary genetic systems just don't make that great treatment graph because it's the class pieces of genes that are not able to do the job and be pathogenic.
That's all true. That's true. So most people from the people
that
are
Yeah, I think we're going to remember actually the early days of bone marrow transplant. People were transplanted and got brought back to the We are transplanting against cancer, so I wanted to have one final question. And that is simply, you know, in your best guess, best prediction, 5 years' time, what technology will be mainstream? I do think that it's likely that IPS phone accounts will push your case in a blood cell product for cancer. Now, beyond that, I'm encouraged by the state that we and I'm anxious to hear what's happening in the Parkinson's disease. I think those will learn a lot more about the cancer. Well, thank you everyone for joining us. I think this has been a fun discussion. We appreciate it. Please give us a